Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday Morning and the Old Cookbook Show. Today, we're going to do a recipe out of this cookbook. We visited it before, the Toronto Queen City of Canada Cookbook. This was published in 1915 here in Toronto. Recap, it was a fundraiser book for a group here in Toronto. The person who put it together was going to give the money from the sales to this group, charity group. Something happened. There was a falling out. The book didn't sell as well as it could have. The group, the charity that was receiving the money, demanded that they remove the section from the front of the cookbook that talked about the charity. So my copy has the first few pages removed that talks about the charity. They continued to try and sell it to recoup their costs. But it was never a very successful book. So today we're going to make something called Egyptian Cannelon. I'm not going to talk about the name just yet. We'll get into making it and then we'll start to address the name. Starts out with 2 pounds of ground beef. To that I'm going to add pepper and salt and just a very small amount of pepper. I'm going to add almonds. It says almonds or pine nuts. I don't know what pine nuts cost where you live, but where I live, almonds are the choice. Next in is parsley, chopped parsley, not too much. And then I'm supposed to grate in some onion. I've got shallots. I'm going to grate in a shallot because I really like the flavor that shallots bring. Okay, now get all of that in there. And you mix it. Mix it by hand. It's the best way. So you're probably wondering why it's called Egyptian. Now, I can't be 100% sure. Everything that I'm going to say about the name of this dish is pure conjecture. But there's a long history in North America, Canada, the United States, of naming recipes in a way that they use something that sounds exotic, like Egypt. Egypt sounds exotic. Or they completely misname it, like a lot of things that are called Dutch something. Dutch apple pie, Dutch baby pancake. Has nothing to do with the Netherlands. Another great example is German chocolate cake. Has nothing to do with Germany. In fact, it used a brand of chocolate put out by the Baker's Company. And the Baker's Company had a brand of chocolate called Germans. German chocolate that signified that it was owned by Mr. German because it was developed by Mr. German. And so he made a cake that used his brand of chocolate. And it was German's chocolate cake, which, you know, when it shows up in a newspaper for the first time, typo maybe, someone makes a typo and they drop the apostrophe S and it becomes German chocolate cake. In this instance, early 1900s, Egyptology, all the rage. There's a lot of books and plays and movies all about Egypt. And people were enthralled with this idea of Egyptology and mummies. And some of you might be figuring out what I'm talking about right now. Some of you might have to ask in the comments, because I'm being very vague and obscure, but if you understand mummification, you might understand why this was called Egyptian Cannelon. Now, I'm supposed to put in here some butter and a cup of stock. So let's pour in about a cup of stock and into the oven. Into the oven for 45 minutes, and I will baste this occasionally with the stock over the paper. Now, while that's baking, I need to thicken the sauce later. And it asks me to rub together 2 tablespoons of butter and 2 of flour. So I've got some butter and I've got some flour. If you've watched this channel at all, you'll know that this is one of my favorite ways of bringing together a sauce at the end of a cook. So I'm just going to mash these together and make a nice homogeneous paste with the butter and the flour. Okay, we're going to pull this out of the oven. Put it over here on the cooktop. And we'll get our cannelon out of the pan. Pretty messy. I've got this on. I want to bring that to a boil. I'm going to put the rest of the beef stock in there. We're going to bring that up to a boil. Onto the platter in one piece. There we go. And we'll get this juice back into the pan with everything else. So messy. And this is where we stir in the beurre manier to thicken it up. Now that butter and flour will melt into the sauce and thicken it up. I'm just gonna get a little bit of a whisk because it also tells me to squeeze in some ketchup if I have it. And since I have some ketchup, we're gonna squeeze some in. There we go. Let's see how that works. Okay, that looks really good. Looks really good. The cannelon doesn't look terribly appetizing, mostly because it didn't brown when it was in the oven. But I'm sure it's going to be really juicy because it was wrapped in that paper and not much escaped. So, gravy over top. Gravy over top. Look at that. Okay, here we go.
Hey, Glenn.
Hey, Jules.
Hey, friends. Meatloaf, your favorite.
Egyptian cannelon.
Okay.
Get a couple of looks.
It leads me to a lot of questions, both about it being what makes it Egyptian and what makes it a cannelon and not a meatloaf.
Yeah, no, there's lots of questions. So we'll get a couple of slices off the end here. Okay, now.
Those almonds?
They are almonds. Okay. It asks for almonds or pine nuts.
Okay.
A little more sauce. There's lots of sauce. You could make the sauce thicker if you wanted to. Make it gravier.
Okay, anything else I should expect other than almonds? Like almonds? I've never had almonds in my...
No.
You know, the usual tomato soup.
Beef, overwhelmingly beef.
Mm-hmm.
What do the almonds bring? I don't know.
A little crunch every so often?
Mm-hmm. There's really not, I mean, there was no other spices in it, really. A little bit of onion, salt and pepper, and parsley.
Mm.
That's pretty much it. So cannelon refers to the shape.
Mm-hmm.
Egyptian, I think. Based on the time period, Egyptology and everything that was happening then, it was wrapped in paper, like a mummy.
Ooh. Okay.
There's no other Egypt connection.
Okay, maybe there's a really great story. I feel like I should make up some kind of really long story that goes with the name
mm-hmm.
to give it, you know, to justify its name. But, I mean, it's not horrid. It's meatloaf. It's, you know.
Yeah, I don't know if the wrapping step really brought anything to it because you don't get any browning. The gravy though is amazing. I do like the gravy.
Okay, so what is so special about the gravy?
There's nothing in it. I mean, it's beef stock, tomato ketchup, and butter.
Ketchup?
Yes.
Okay, I wasn't expecting ketchup. I'm gonna just, you know. So that's the tang I was getting.
Yeah.
Okay, so I was trying to put the tang flavor that was in my mouth with your description of almonds, onions, and parsley.
Yeah. No, it's the ketchup that's bringing
that. It's the ketchup. So that's a key component to this recipe then, to make it.
It's got good texture, it's juicy, it's moist. So maybe wrapping it does do something. But I would definitely spice it completely differently. I would do my regular meatloaf, wrap it up, cook it this way, and then make the gravy and pour it over at the end.
Although, you know, if you were someone who always made really dry meatloaf.
Yes.
This would be a technique to put into your...
Yes.
You know?
Yeah. So maybe Egyptian cannelon of beef with a different set of spices would be better. I'm still going to eat this like there's no tomorrow because I love meatloaf.
You do love meatloaf.
I love meatloaf. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.